When I was young, I never needed anyone. And making love was just fun. Those days are gone.
Sorry about that. I'm James Zimmerman, and I was just listening to a little Celine Dion to get in the mood to talk about one of the most fabulously juicy clarinet solos in all of the repertoire, Rachmaninoff's Second Piano Concerto. This solo doesn't get asked in auditions that often. Rachmaninoff's Second Symphony is a lot more common, but a lot of the issues we're going to talk about today will come up in both solos. I'm in the preparation stage now, and I'm focusing heavily on intonation. This solo has a lot of intonation pitfalls which are really easy to fall into. Number one, it's in a sharp register of the instrument, so we have to manage the sharpness. Number two, the clarinet has a propensity to come in too sharp when it makes an entrance, which makes it difficult to dovetail with the people around us, like the flute, the piano, and the second clarinet. So we have to figure out how to make an entrance without being too sharp. And number three, there's a lot of the note high B in this solo, and high B is a really strange note on A clarinet. It's a little bit too sharp, but it has a beautiful sound. So we have to figure out how to really manage that note in particular. When I'm getting ready to play a big solo like this, I'll usually listen to a recording just to refresh my memory. I found one on YouTube where somebody had put the music on the screen to follow along with while we listen, but this poor clarinet player falls into every single trap I just mentioned. Bless their heart. Listen to this. Alright, I've piled on this poor person enough. It's just that I have no patience when I hear clarinet players, myself included, doing the things that everyone else hates us for. I have no idea who that player was, but if I were to meet them, I would say, in the spirit of NFL Hall of Fame wide receiver Chris Carter,
"Come on, man! I mean, come on, man! Come on, man! You're making money! Come on! I mean, come on, man! Come on!"
We can do better than this! We must do better than this! So what's the best way to work on it? One option is to use a tuner. There's an app I like called Tonal Energy, which has a powerful analysis feature that graphs both your intonation and the volume of your sound in real time. Let me show you what this looks like. Pretty cool, right? There's so much deeper you can go with this app too, and it's only $3.99, so check it out. The thing is though, playing in tune is actually a moving target. I'm sure most of you know this already, but depending on where the note you're playing fits into the harmony around you, you need to adjust your intonation accordingly. Here's a chart I found on the National Flute Association website showing exactly where every scale degree needs to be placed to sound perfectly in tune. It's in the right-hand column. Using the information from this table, I'm going to show you just how much of a moving target this Rachmaninoff solo really is. I created this spreadsheet. The first column shows what clarinet note is being played. The second column shows what harmony that note fits into. The third column shows what scale degree that note is. And the fourth column shows exactly where that note needs to land pitch-wise. Then I took the data from the fourth column and turned it into a line graph to make it more visually appealing. Let's listen to that same recording again as we follow along with this graph. Thank you. Pretty crazy, right? You can see how sometimes, if you have two of the same note in a row, you have to change the pitch of the second one to accommodate the shifting harmony around you. It's also easy to understand now why this player's last note of the second phrase sounds so good. That note is supposed to be 16 cents sharp, but because this poor player doesn't correct the clarinet's tendency to naturally go sharp as he makes a diminuendo, the note actually lands in the right place. Based on all the other intonation problems this player had throughout the solo, I think it's pretty safe to assume that this player just got lucky here. So, tonal energy might have you believing that you're striving for a green line right across the zero during the entire solo, but now we can see that that's not at all what you're looking for. There's a much better way to work on intonation, and that's with a tone generator. I use this Dr. Beat DB88 metronome that I got in grad school. Let me show you how I do this. First, to get a perfect dovetail with the flute, I'll put the drone on E5 and I'll practice coming in with a note that's not sharp. Then I might put it on an E4 to practice coming in an octave above the note. That's a hard one. Then I might try a B4. Tuning intervals is great because if you're right in the slot, you'll hear a nice resultant tone, which is a third tone which emerges as a result of summing two tones together. This is a great online tone generator I found. I'll put a link in the description so you can find it. What you can do here is open two browser tabs simultaneously and play two different notes and listen to the resultant tones like this. This one I have set to B4. This one I have set to E5. And if you play them at the same time, you'll hear a low E3 come out. This website is great and it's free. It has a lot more features, so check it out. The last thing I'll do is just put the drone on and play the whole solo and try to get every note in tune. Then I'll move it down to an A for the second phrase. As I continue to practice with the tone generator, I realize that most of the adjustments I'm having to make are to lower the pitch. So here's an idea. Why don't we pull out a little bit more than we usually would? Going back to the graphs, look at how many of these pitch points are below the zero. It just makes sense to pull out, doesn't it? Just keep in mind that in the performance, your A clarinet will have been sitting there through the whole first movement, so it might be a little colder than you want it to be. So take that into consideration. So that's why I prefer to use a tone generator. It forces you to tune with your ears instead of your eyes. With a tuner, especially one with as many bells and whistles as tonal energy, it's easy to get distracted and stop listening to yourself. You might fall into that trap of playing perfectly in tune but with a garbage sound. That'll never fly with a tone generator. Also, I hate to roast that clarinet player from the recording so bad. It's just that good intonation is much more than people can hear. It's something they feel. So if you can really lock it in, it makes a huge difference. I'm not too concerned with phrasing or timing issues at this point because a lot of that will depend on what the soloist does. Our soloist for this performance is Joyce Yang. She's a great friend of the orchestra, so I'm looking forward to doing this piece with her. And our conductor is Lawrence Foster, who was most recently here 2 years ago for a great performance of Dvorak's New World Symphony, so I'm looking forward to seeing him again. So that's about it for preparation. Let's go to work and see if any of this actually helps.
Living alone, think of all the friends I've known. But when I dial the telephone, nobody's home.
So, today is Tuesday, and we have just finished a full day's rehearsals of Tchaikovsky and Mantovani. And I am lucky enough to be joined by our maestro for this week, Mr. Lawrence Foster. Thank you so much for taking a minute to do this for us.
Pleasure. It's a pleasure.
If you had to guess, how many times do you think you've conducted the Rachmaninoff Second Piano Concerto?
Maybe not quite as much as some people. Certainly 50 or 60 times, isn't it?
Only 50 or 60, huh?
Yeah.
When you're getting ready to conduct that clarinet solo in the second movement, what's usually going through your mind?
Fear. No, it depends. If it's a pianist that is interested in what the orchestra is doing, it's easy. There's no problem at all. So of course, it's one of the great, beautiful solos. Rachmaninoff, as you know well, he loved the clarinet, and I think some of his finest music, I mean, the Second Symphony is not a favorite of mine, but when it comes to the big clarinet solo, it's heaven, you know? In this solo, I once did it with a famous pianist who was one of the great pianists ever born, but he just felt that the clarinet had to follow him no matter what he did. I mean, there was Shura Cherkasky was his name, was a great pianist, and we did it on tour, and there was absolutely, really no way of knowing what he was going to do, where he was going to slow or speed up. And I think the clarinet player, whose name was Tony Pei, from the RPO, I think almost had to go to a psychiatrist at the end of the tour. It can be free as long as you feel kind of the motivation of it. But if it just comes out of nowhere with rubatos, as if he's playing, you know, all by himself in a salon room somewhere, it makes life very, very tough for the clarinet, and I guess for the conductor.
Have you worked with Joyce before?
No, I haven't. I've heard so much about her, and I certainly look forward to it.
Will you have a chance to meet Joyce before the rehearsal?
I guess so.
What do you usually talk about at those meetings?
What we can have for dinner? I don't like going through the pieces very much with the soloists. I prefer to kind of get it by instinct if I can, because I love accompanying, so I try to put myself into the heart, into the head of the soloist, and then accompany in that way. And it usually works out quite well. I don't like overly to discuss these things and to prepare. Then you lose something. I'm certainly not going to go over that solo with her. I'm going to just see how we all let it happen, so to speak. I mean, I know how you play, and I imagine that she's also terrific, so there's no reason, you know, I'm not going to sit down and say, well, here, do you take time, or this or that. I mean, the ideal is when the clarinetist goes to the pianist and they just play it together, and then once then you get on the stage, everyone kind of has the right feeling of what they want to do. And basically, I'll stay out of the way anyway.
Perfect. I really appreciate you taking a minute. Get some sleep, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Well, I look very much forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, good morning. Today's Wednesday, and I'm downstairs in the keyboard storage room directly underneath the stage at the Skirmerhorn Symphony Center. The symphony owns two pianos, one American Steinway and one Hamburg Germany Steinway, and our soloist will have the chance to pick between the two of them later. We also have this Baldwin upright, fabulously colored piano, which for some reason most of the soloists do not choose. There's also a lot of other cool stuff down here, like a rain stick, some nuts, a lint roller, some kind of drum. I also found this really cool clarinet stand. I did not know we owned this. This morning the piano tuner came to tune the pianos, and I just wanted to see where the pitch is lying. So, this one here looks like a little above A440. And this one over here riding just a little bit above A440. Interesting. During our lunch break today, the pianos will ride up to the stage on this huge elevator, like this. You know what I really want to do is, during our next audition, put the candidates right on the lift, so when we're done listening to them, we can send them down to the basement, like... Alright, I gotta get off stage and let Joyce warm up, so I'll catch you at rehearsal.
Am I too slow?
So in that first run-through of the solo, I think we learned two major pieces of information. One, tempo. Joyce started a little slower than I would have liked, but I went with her during the first phrase, I tried to move it during the second phrase, and by the third phrase, things were feeling pretty good. Number two, intonation. I was worried my A would be flat since it had been sitting there for over half an hour when we started rehearsing the second movement, and I overcorrected a little bit and I ended up being sharp, so I'll make sure that doesn't happen in the concert. After we finished that section, Larry cut us off and he had one compliment and two comments for us.
One little request, that's gorgeous. It's as gorgeous as anything could be. One little thing only. In the clarinet solo, could you make a huge crescendo before 18, two bars? Ti-ra-di-ra-di-ram. Just a lot. And then also, may I ask you in the piano, if you wouldn't mind, to not make any diminuendo really here, where you have to lead back to the clarinet. Da-dee-da-dee-da-ram. Okay. Otherwise, it sounds like he's coming in with an accent.
Both of those comments have to do with ensemble. With the first comment, Larry wants to make sure I do a better job of bringing the orchestra in when I'm done with the solo. And with the second comment, he wants to make sure Joyce and I get a better dovetail. Otherwise, he had nothing to say, which is nice, because sometimes conductors feel like they have to say something, like,
really sing there. Take your time.
Don't take too much time.
I'll just follow you there.
Listen to the piano. She's the soloist. You are the soloist.
We don't need to do that again.
Would you mind if we did that one more time?
Ah, much better. So after Larry made those two comments, we went right on to the next section. So you can hear throughout that section that as we went on, most of the ensemble problems worked themselves out as we listened to one another. After we finished this section, Larry had one very insightful comment for me and Eric. Listen to this.
These triplets in the clarinet, don't overdo it. Wait, keep it down. It'll sound like an exercise or some proof that we can be together. Okay?
That's a very easy trap to fall into when you've worked so hard on something, is to sound like you're trying to prove that you can do a good job. That happens a lot in auditions, so just watch out for that. After that, we didn't rehearse the beginning of the movement at all anymore. We just kept going on. Mostly, it was a pretty uneventful rehearsal, except for when Larry tried to cut Joyce off at the beginning of the third movement and kind of startled her.
It's go time right there. I did not think he was gonna stop me.
After rehearsal, Joyce and I got together to talk and play through some things.
So, we just finished rehearsal. This is Joyce Yang. Thank you so much for joining me for a minute. Can you play the beginning of the second movement and just show everybody how this is grouped? In the piano music, it's written in groups of four, right? Every four notes, there's a quarter note?
Yes. It creates some kind of timelessness because there is that discrepancy as to where is the downbeat, and it's many different things going on. I'll play it and then we can get into it.
Yeah. It almost sounds like it's in three. Two. Three. So then when the flute comes in, it sounds more like 12-8.
Yes.
I'll play the flute part. I lost count because I was listening to that.
So it gives it that, you know, really play and what time signature are we in? What should we be counting in our system? But it's that...
It's just...
Hard to be sure.
What time it's in.
And very often we ask, where is the downbeats? And it's really there to confuse you sometimes and bring you to a different place.
Can we just play our part?
Yes.
I'm actually being serious. Like, can we go like this much faster?
Sure.
Just that much faster.
Okay.
Is that cool with you?
Yes.
I feel kind of powerless to make it go faster because you're moving faster than me. You've got the triplets, I've got the eighth notes. So the piano is a little bit more in control of the tempo than the clarinet. And I just...
Sometimes I feel so insecure.
I think it's probably my fault for starting it quite slowly sometimes. And some conductors actually have asked me to be musical with my line instead of being this backdrop that that creates no time whatsoever and I just float. I like to just float as your hopefully beautiful E major for me is. It has a pinkish hue, so it's a lot of perfume and it's quite magical. Start to a movement. So
I think now that we've done this, tomorrow people will go with us. And Larry's being great. He's just leaving it up to us.
You know, that does scare me sometimes when there's discrepancy between the clarinet and the strings because you play the same thing at some point and sometimes it's not together and I get stuck in the middle trying to play the melody at the right time. And it is really like you're skiing and your two legs are going in two different places and you have to, you know, hang in there. So it can get pretty challenging sometimes when there's not a great ensemble between the sections. Strings are behind me, clarinet is at the back of the orchestra, so the ensemble can be
distant and obscure.
I guess you really never know how it's gonna go till the concert.
Thank you so much for being willing to be interviewed and good luck in the concerts. I'm glad to have you back.
Thank you. Look forward to playing with you.
I feel like that was super helpful to get together with Joyce and go through that stuff. So now all we have left is our dress rehearsal and three performances, so I'll be back when those are finished. Hey, the concerts are done. Feels like they went great. The audience responded well. I got a solo bow every night. I have the sense that each concert was better than the previous night, but let's go back to my house and listen to tonight's concert and see if that's actually true. What we're looking at here is a recording of the first rehearsal and a recording of the Saturday night concert. This isn't the kind of music that belongs on a click track, so I just have a timer up here. And I've color-coded the piece by sections. We have pink for the piano entrance, fuchsia for the flute entrance, crimson for the clarinet solo, and teal for the triplets. This section represents about 3.5 minutes worth of music, and you can see by this gap over here that we went about 6 seconds faster across this section in the concert on Saturday than we did in the first rehearsal.
So it's not much, but it makes a huge difference in terms of breathing. I also put my run-through with Joyce in here, and if we slide over here, we can compare them more easily. We can see that in the first rehearsal, we went a little too slow. In the run-through, we went a little too fast. And in the concert, it was just right. Sliding back over here, I'll get rid of the stuff that we don't need and we'll listen to this performance. Let me zoom in just on the part that I need. I'll put the music on the screen like usual. And let's check it out. So after listening to this performance, I have mixed feelings. I'll start with the good. First, I thought the dovetails with the flute and piano were great. Larry's request to have Joyce refrain from making a diminuendo on the way into the second phrase really helped a lot. I also think the pacing was great. Not only did it enable me to breathe comfortably, but it also made all the rubatos happen really naturally. On the negative side, I still feel like my intonation could have been better. One thing I did that really helped was I switched to my A at the end of the first movement during this rest, which allowed me to blow some air through my A during these rests, and then in between movements when the audience invariably clapped, I could set my barrel where it needed to be and test the first note of the solo, but still, I left room for improvement. What I should have done during preparation is practice making unison entrances with a drone on high B. I didn't really do that very much, and that could have tightened things up a little bit. I discovered something interesting while I was reviewing the recordings of the first rehearsal. I had four different audio sources to choose from. The GoPro camera on my stand, a Zoom H2 in between me and Eric, a set of Neumann KM84s above the wind section, and then another set of mics that was hanging above the conductor podium and piano. And my intonation sounded different on every set of mics. So this raised a lot of questions about how sound travels over distance and how different parts of our sound project differently. I'm not sure what to make of it right now, but I'll be thinking about that a lot going forward. My recommendation to you all is to record yourself in a variety of spaces at a variety of distances and see if that tells you anything. Overall, it was a fun week and it was great to play the Rachmaninoff again. I was grateful that Joyce is such a great chamber musician, and I was thankful that Larry trusted us enough to just make it happen. His comments were helpful, but overall he took a less is more approach, and I think that works great. It helps us listen better. I think that's it for this one. I hope you found this helpful and enjoyable, and as always, your feedback is greatly appreciated. You can leave a comment here, you can email me at clarinetjobs@gmail.com, or you can head over to our new website at clarinetjobs.com and contact me there. So until next time, happy practicing and happy Valentine's Day.